think Philip can jump up and join us.
Scott, Philip, and Chris are available to take any questions now.
And if not, we can discuss about the cars. So
let's head to dinner. Oh, wait a minute.
You talked about the dealer's 97 exclusive, and they're building the new facilities. How much are they putting in on a percentage basis versus what Audi's putting in?
On almost 99% of the deals that we make, dealers are putting 100% of their capital on the table. And a few deals in the very, very big markets where you have extremely, extremely high cost of real estate, we've jumped in on the real estate and then collect rent from that dealer. But those are relatively rare. And these are the types of deals you'll see in the industry in the big, expensive real estate markets.
What portion of the total dealer body do you expect to be exclusive when you're finished with this phase?
We haven't set an exact number, but I think the ideal scenario is to have 100%. And that's what we're going to push for every day. So, but I think, if you look at the summit, a good example is Miami, which is a market we focused on. And we've got four dealers, four new hangar facilities. We focus communications there. And, Miami's up 30% this year on Audi. So if you get this thing right of the market, the dealers investing in it, good things happen. And that's, Miami's a classic example of what's happening there. Yeah. Or L.A., for example, is another good one. Downtown L.A., we have a new hangar down there. And L.A.'s up 18, 19% this year.
You talked about the vulnerabilities of your competition. What are those vulnerabilities?
I'm not going to spend time. I think the competitors make tremendous product. The opportunity we see is, to turn it around a little bit, is that, in a lot of these markets, you're seeing 25% share of Mercedes and BMW. So I think there is an opportunity just because there's so many of them on the ground in these markets that we've seen a lot of research as people are looking for something different. They are looking for an alternative. So I think it's that's the extent of it. They make great products, all of them.
I noticed there's some new products, new facilities being built with Audi as one element and a Porsche as another element in more or less matching buildings. I've seen a couple of those. Is that part of your program? Is that a dealer's personal thing? Do you have arrangements with Porsche to allow that to happen? Or
The setup and the strategy that we want to have is clearly a dedicated standalone Audi facility, right. And that's the 97 that we have. But if you look at the historical arrangements with Volkswagen, with Porsche, and I think that's what you see. You still see a lot of the bleeding and the blending.
But I mean, they're separate facilities on the same piece of property.
Yeah, and that's a case of you have an owner who owns both those franchises, and boom. But for us, the goal, standalone.
Okay, a lot of
it's got to be a product question there.
A lot of interest on our facilities. That's interesting, Aaron.
What are you guys going to be doing with diesels?
If you want to jump in, or you want me to take that?
Actually, I'd offer Philip that question.
Thank you. That's a popular question. it's obviously no secret that that diesel is one of our key competencies in Europe and around the world. You have obviously noticed what we have been doing with racing as far as diesel goes. So all of that, you can imagine, has some purpose. And we cannot really stand here tonight and confirm any concrete plans, but rest assured that we are definitely looking into that technology and seeing what are the possibilities to bring into this market. Looking for the right technological solutions that we need to meet the emission standards and things of that nature. But rest assured, that's something we're working on, and look forward to for announcements from us in the future.
I'm curious as to, Mercedes is starting with their diesels and their the E-Class and the SUVs and the larger cars. Mm-hmm. Would you go in that direction, or would you look at diesels for highly fuel-efficient smaller cars, or can you say?
We have both in Europe. We have a very wide choice of diesels. And that goes for smaller, more economy-tuned, you know, vehicles, if you would. And it takes it all the way up to 12-cylinder diesel that we have just launched or announced in Europe for the Audi Q7. So we have some pretty amazing diesels as well, and what you could consider calling power diesels. So the availability is there. We have looked at and are looking at the opportunities that we might be able to get in this market. As far as which specific car lines, I don't think we're ready to make that call quite yet. But what we can say is that we would look at you know, a wide application. That means if we're going to come, not just one product line, but a more broader range of offerings for this market.
I think just to add that one, we clearly would be looking for a 50-state solution, which I think is the key. And I think that's what you're seeing with the, you know, the E320 CDI is a 45-state solution, and a 50-state solution is the key to making this work. California, Massachusetts, you know, New York.
Question back here, and then we'll grab one.
Had a previous Audi and are now getting into a new vehicle.
You want to jump on that?
Are you talking about the Audi Advantage?
He's talking about the free maintenance. He's talking about. He's talking about maintenance, not warranty. Yeah.
Okay, I didn't catch that question.
How are they reacting to the new?
How are you positioning it to customers had a previous Audi and now they won't have the maintenance?
So far, the reaction, if I can call it reaction, we haven't really seen that much reaction, to be quite honest. Part of it is obviously the fact that, and Scott touched a little bit on this in the presentation, and maybe we haven't addressed it in a lot of detail tonight, but you will see, even if you look at the latest IQS numbers, that our quality numbers have been increasing, you know, or improving, should I say, tremendously. So from that standpoint also, you know, it's been, you know, the newest models are getting so good that we don't see that much of an issue with that.
We're not seeing it in letters to us at Audi in any significant way. Scott and I know, read every one of those letters that come in. Certainly from a CSI, an SSI, and from an appeal standpoint, it seems to be playing out. And then anecdotally, the salespeople aren't telling us anything significant on that end, so I think it's playing out well.
And that changes for 07 model year, not 06, right?
Correct.
407.
So, yeah.
Not a lot of data at this point.
Correct.
I also add another comment. I'll speak loudly. The question
from the product perspective is also, what does the competition do? That's always the first question. Whenever we have a new idea, you take a look at the competition first as a very basic idea. And competitors like Lexus have never had free maintenance. Some competitors have reduced it. Whenever you change a situation, you always want to offer the customer an alternative. We've done so. It's called Audi Care for approximately $500, which actually has a value of much more than that. A customer has an alternative of purchasing a thing called Audi Care, and that involves placing the Audi Care purchase to a specific VIN number. So a customer can go to any dealer in the United States after they've purchased that Audi Care, and they can get the kind of maintenance that they want and that they expect. And naturally, one would expect that the take rate is higher on the higher level vehicles than the lower priced vehicles. But it has been successful. We don't have the exact details tonight, but we've certainly offered an alternative to customers who have asked for that kind of treatment. So, again, competitively, some competitors have it, some don't. But we certainly, again, as Philip mentioned, have a very qualitative product that is extremely reliable now at this point, and we certainly stand behind that in every way.
Kind of goes back to the diesel questions. I mean, I think that in America, the fuel is part of our problem. Is Audi adding its voice in Washington? Are you standing up to say, you know, we have all the products required, or they have all the technology required? What we need is fuel.
Absolutely.
And, okay.
We have a representative in Washington, D.C. that we've that we worked actively with, and our voice is being heard there along with the Alliance.
And I think if you look at the recent announcements from Honda and some of the other manufacturers, this is irrefutably going to start to build with Mercedes, with Audi, with Honda, and there'll be more announcements that'll get the government moving, get the gas moving, and then get technology moving. The biggest one, get customer acceptance heading in the direction of diesels. Sorry, Patrick, I think he's going to go, but
we got a microphone.
You guys mentioned technology leadership. Your competitors have or have announced hybrids. Where are you guys at with that?
What do you want to tell you? Sorry.
You may be surprised to know that we actually did have we do have some past with hybrids, it dates itself back to the 80s when we had the Audi Duo. You may recall. So there's definitely some of that. Besides that, I think that we have looked at a variety of possibilities. As you know, last Frankfurt, we actually showed an Audi Q7 concept, which was a hybrid, and so we didn't absolutely say no to that question. Not to say that we are not weighing carefully the fact that diesel is yet another alternative. And that is one that perhaps we may want to present, we have not completely said no to hybrids.
Just the other thing, just to follow up a little bit on that one, I mean, it is going to have to be a total solution. So if you look at real world now, whether it's with FSI, lightweight aluminum, you have an A3 and an A4 that are the most fuel efficient vehicles in its class. So you need that world, diesel world, potentially move on to the hybrids as well. But it's going to come with lightweight transmissions, all that world, diesel, hybrids for a full solution. I don't think there's going to be one silver bullet at this stage yet. Patrick.
I'm just curious about Audi's racing program and racing history. Obviously, you spent a lot of money and you've been very successful, but what kind of impact does that have as far as U.S. customers? How many people come into the dealership based on Audi's success in racing?
Yeah, I think there's two things here. One, it is absolute at the heart and core of the brand of bringing racing and then bring it into the real world there. And I think one of the things that we've been is we've been this humble company that sits down and races and sort of puts its head down and says, well, we'll race. And we haven't focused on the promotion of those things. And I think what we're going to do is start to talk about it more and promote it more. We've always been much more of a do company, and we'll just do it and people will magically find out about it. I think now we've got to put our shoulders back a little bit, make some noise, get a little more aggressive, sometimes be a little less Audi than we've traditionally been to get people to know these things. Because you know the number one thing I've learned about this, someone sits in an Audi, they look at an Audi, you tell them something about it, and they go, I had no idea. And this is the general reaction if you're not an insider journalist or someone who's an aficionado, and that's what we have to try to turn around.
And actually, I'd like to add something to that. I handle PR for the team. And we had the American Le Mans series had, this is not directly related, but just along the same lines. They had a meeting called State of the Series, where they go over the season up to that point, how things have been, blah, blah, blah. There is an 80% increase in television viewership. And just last weekend at Road Atlanta for Petit Le Mans, there was 90,000 people. And a lot of that has to do with our participation this year with the diesel race car. They're not shy about that fact. They didn't say it in the meeting, but talking with people in the LMS, it became very clear that we had a lot to do with it. So it is being noticed.
Do you think that, like, Porsche obviously jumped in this year and then next year, and then next year Acura is coming in. Do you think these companies come in because of Audi, or has Audi's role been what kind of pushed them in? You know, not totally, obviously, but I mean, have they looked at Audi and said, hey, they're in there, we're going to get in this, it's a good opportunity for marketing?
Obviously, Audi's success is a huge factor in the series success, the growing success it's had over the last approximately 4 or 5 seasons. And Audi is part of a package. I mean, you see Porsche, Aston Martin, Ferrari, premium makes in the series. So I think it helps as a whole. And being as successful as Audi has been has definitely helped probably lure in other companies like Lexus and Acura for next year.
I think the other thing to remember is that they offer a great package to get into motorsports, where you're not paying NASCAR or F1 type of prices, but you're competing, and they offer a great publicity package as well with that. So we have to give those guys credit for what they do.
And the other thing that's going to be key for next year for ALMS is they're getting it in the right markets. I mean, there will be a race in Long Beach next year, be a race in Detroit. So it's key to get this stuff, all due respect to Milwaukee and places like that, but it's important to get these things in California as well to start to get the people there. And if you look at, you know, IRL and CART, where that's going, it's basically NASCAR is the king, and I think there's open for another race series. And I think that's what we're seeing with ALMS, with the competition jumping in, and it's booming. And actually, we like it. We like the fact that Acura's jumping in because it gets more people to the track, and it shows what we can do. So,
okay. About one last question.
You've won Le Mans repeatedly. How many times do you go back and prove it over and over?
We're gonna have you drive the car next year, and if we get a victory, then we'll stop.
All right.
We'll see. We're gonna keep racing.
Great. Thank you. We are all available during dinner. It's a strolling dinner, so take the opportunity to spend time with any the members up here. And I'd also like to introduce Richard Petit, who is representing B&O tonight, Bang & Olufsen. And we have two vehicles here tonight outfitted with the B&O system, which you'll also get a chance to experience tomorrow on the drive. And I understand Richard has a special CD with him that he'll use to demonstrate the capabilities of the system. So ask Richard about that. Also ask him about his experience at Barrett-Jackson this year. I think he's got an interesting story. And with that, please join us for dinner.
Thank you.